Hi everyone, welcome this evening to our webinar. My name is Louise Underhill and I'm the Lung Cancer Support Nurse at Lung Foundation Australia. We are Australia's only national charity supporting those with lung cancer and lung disease. I would like to start this evening by acknowledging the traditional custodians of the land on which we meet. We wish to acknowledge and pay respect to their continuing culture and the contribution they make to life of this city and this region. We would also like to welcome Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people who may be listening to today's webinar. Tonight is our sixth and final webinar on the Lung Cancer Connect series, and this is entitled Supported Care in Lung Cancer. Okay, so let's get started. And first up, I'm going to introduce you to our other presenter for today. I'd like you to welcome Louise Durham. Louise is a nurse practitioner with the Metro South Palliative Care Service. And Louise is now going to begin her presentation.
Thanks everyone, good evening and welcome to the webinar. So I work as a nurse practitioner in the rural and remote area of Metro South Brisbane. So this is a large geographical area within our region that extends down to the New South Wales border and also encompasses the Southern Moreton Bay Islands, which is classified by Primary Health Network as being remote. So I've worked in palliative care for more than 20 years across a variety of settings, both in hospital and community. And it's my privilege to speak with you tonight about palliative and supportive care, an approach with so much to offer people with serious illness. So it's useful at this stage to define what palliative care is, and the World Health Organization offers this definition on the screen here. So it's an approach that improves the quality of life for patients and their families facing the problems associated with life-limiting illness through prevention and relief of suffering by means of early identification and impeccable assessment and treatment of pain and other problems, physical, psychosocial and spiritual. Palliative and supportive care is also described by the World Health Organization as active and total care. So it's not so much an approach that stands back and does nothing, but it's really quite active. And just wanted to, hopefully you can see this slide and the image on the slide. This picture is a lovely artwork that is of a woman from ancient Rome, and the garment around her head and shoulders is what is called a palla, which is where our definition of palliative word comes from the Latin, which is this cloak. So the aim of wearing the palla back in the day was to shield you from the elements, from whatever was happening, harsh elements. So I guess palliative care in that respect is kind of a nice symbol of being a shield, something to protect you. So what does palliative care do? So we do a lot of things. We provide relief from pain and other distressing symptoms, for example, shortness of breath. Palliative care is a philosophy that affirms life and regards dying as a normal part of life also. The approach intends neither to hasten death nor prolong it. And it's an approach that integrates the psychological and spiritual aspects of patient care. So there's a focus on the whole person. And when I use the word spiritual, I don't necessarily mean religious, but really spiritual aspects of care are about how a person relates not only to themselves, but the people around them, their significant others in a meaningful way. So we offer a support system to help people live as actively as possible until the time that their end of life approaches. So doing all of that really involves a multidisciplinary team approach. So within our palliative care service, it varies across the country, but we have doctors, nurse practitioners like myself, clinical nurse consultants, clinical nurse case managers, social workers, occupational therapists and counsellors. So having a support team that you can draw on alongside can be of great benefit in navigating the changing needs and issues that are associated with serious illness. So we use a team approach to address the needs of patients and their families. For us, it's not just the person with the diagnosis of cancer, it's their families as well. So we kind of look after a family unit. We enhance the quality of life, and that may also positively influence the course of the illness, and we'll touch on that a little bit later in the presentation. We discuss options for practical nursing help, which can improve home supports, and offer a backup of just being there. So for example, and again, this varies across the country, but our service has an on-call telephone service. So if after hours, if people are having problems with any symptoms, they can ring an on-call number and speak to a nurse such as myself, and we can often give advice. And this can often avoid an unnecessary hospital presentation, which is good. We can discuss options for equipment, and we also help to facilitate the option to remain at home for end-of-life care when that time does come. So studies have shown that 75% of us in this country would prefer to die at home, but the reality is that most of that percentage of people actually end up in hospitals. So another big part of our work is advanced care planning. So we're doing a lot of work at the moment in what's called a statement of choices, and I think in Victoria it's called respecting patient choices, or advanced care directives, advanced health directives. So the aim of that is really about empowering people to make choices about the sort of care that they would want to receive, or conversely not want to receive, when their health is declining. As much as possible, we aim to meet the needs of people in their local communities. So, example, our patient clinics closer to home, rather than people always needing to come into the big acute hospitals that are some hours drive in some cases. We also provide consult support for health professionals in remote areas. So, example, GPs in little communities hours out of our major city centres. So I just wanted to show you a quick video, and it goes for a couple of minutes, but it really sums up very eloquently by BJ Miller what it is that we do in palliative care.
Many people you start with, what's that? The interdisciplinary pursuit of quality of life. And the context is always advanced or serious illness. Palliative care is irrespective of the clock. You don't have to be dying anytime soon. The curiosity from the public tends to be, and I hear this all the time, wow, that must be, you know, that must be so depressing. You know, you must be depressed all the time. It's not always happy by a long shot, but there's this side effect that seems to come. By facing mortality, it seems to inform how you live. So the secret is that facing death has a lot to do with living well. The whole reason I went into medicine was because I became a patient. In college, sophomore year, my dear friends and I were horsing around one night. We decided to climb a parked train. I happened to have a metal watch on, and when I stood up, the electricity arced to the watch, and that was that. It was sort of an introduction to my own death, my own sense of mortality, my own finiteness. You're the object of a lot of sympathy, pity, a lot of head tilts. At first, it's kind of sweet, but then it starts turning a little saccharine. You quickly look down that road, and it's not too long before you realize that's a dead end. That's just another way of removing yourself or being removed from the flow of society. One of the ways that I got through some of the early days was insisting that this was a variation on a theme we all experience, and that theme is basically is suffering. Some way, life is not gonna do what you want it to do. Your body's not gonna do what you want it to do. You will suffer. It's unavoidable. Then there's this unnecessary rind of suffering, which is so, which is the demoralizing part, because it's the invented stuff. It comes in terms of how we treat each other, sometimes poorly. It comes in those moments of abandonment. We end up warehousing folks who are sitting on piles of wisdom and experience and just plain hilarious or good stories. If we can sort of shift that a little bit, there's a lot more peace waiting for all of us as we age. I think a lot of us are really worried, not so much about the fact that we die, but how we die. Very often, patients themselves, the people doing the dying, we'll get to a place of acceptance. Beyond acceptance even, you know, ready to go. You're done. You're done with this body. A lot of the effort, my effort, the team's effort, the hospice organization's effort is actually not so much on the patient, the person doing the dying, it's on the family. In a way, it's harder to accept the death of another person than accept your own, especially when you really love that person. I'm BJ Miller, and this is my brief but spectacular take on dying and living.
So, BJ Miller is a bit of a legend, really, in palliative care circles, but I think he really sums it up so well in terms of, you know, looking at it. It's not just about the dying part, but it really is about the living and how to live well with good quality. And I think that's where palliative care has a lot to offer. So when is palliative care applicable? It's applicable early in the course of illness. So the World Health Organization, again, in its definitions of palliative care and the aims of palliative care, says that it's really in conjunction with other therapies that are intended to prolong life, such as chemotherapy and radiotherapy, and includes those investigations needed to better understand and manage clinical complications. The next bullet point there on your slide is that it's applicable throughout the course of illness and not something to be afraid of. I think there have been some studies done that have shown that palliative care has become associated purely with end-of-life care, and therefore it's seen as quite a scary thing to be referred to palliative care. It's really, I think that's where the term supportive care is becoming more of a focus, as in it's more applicable across the course, the journey, rather than right at the end. And so there is some evidence to say that early palliative care involvement actually positively influences the course of an illness. And just mentioning a study that was done in the US back about 9 years ago now by Temel, and what this study did was to study the outcomes of a group of patients that were with lung cancer who were separated out from usual care patients. So they compared two groups essentially. One group of patients received purely palliative support, and the other group of patients with lung cancer received usual care. And what the study showed was that the patients that received just purely palliative approach to care had better quality of life, less depressive symptoms, and less aggressive treatments right at the end of life, and they actually lived longer than the usual care group. So that's really quite an amazing study. So just in concluding my part of the presentation, I just wanted to run through with you one last slide. This is taken from the optimal care pathway for people with lung cancer that was produced by the Cancer Council of Australia in 2016. So there are four tenets there of that optimal care pathway. The first is that care is patient-centered. Second is that the care is safe and high quality and evidence-based. The third is that it's multidisciplinary care. We know that providing multidisciplinary approach to care improves patient outcomes. And the fourth is supportive care across the continuum of care. And I just thought that was really interesting because those four tenets of care are actually what palliative care does as well. So they kind of go together hand in hand. So just leave you with some references from the presentation this evening, and look forward to answering any of your questions that you might have. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Louise. So that concludes Louise's presentation. So I'm now going to give a presentation exploring some further ideas, and I may touch on some things that Louise has already covered, but then it'll just be good reinforcement to have a look at it from another perspective. So again, I'm the lung cancer support nurse here at Lung Foundation Australia. Later on, you will get the contact details that you can contact me if you have like to have an individual discussion about your case. All right, so So lung cancer. So at the time of diagnosis of lung cancer, when undergoing treatment and after active treatment completes, patients experience profound emotional and spiritual distress, as well as physical symptoms and limited bodily function. Over 2/3 of patients with advanced cancer report pain of some kind, dyspnea, or it's also known as breathlessness, fatigue, loss of appetite, anxiety, and changes in your bowel habits are also common. So with that, we mean either diarrhea or the other end of the scale, constipation. Individual experience is unique depending on your personal history, your circumstances, and your social settings. So palliative care, we'll go through these ideas again. The aim is to alleviate symptoms and enhance your quality of life. And the palliative care team, now it's can consist of specialised doctors, nurses, social workers and chaplains. Also within that, you also have allied health professionals. The team can vary wherever you are and your treatment centre. It may be a smaller team, or it could even be your GP who just liaises with the supportive care services that are available in your community or accessed through your local hospitals. So palliative care, it follows principles of patient-centered care with emphasis on the well-being of the patients and the families coping with a serious medical illness, and it can occur at any point along their disease trajectory, whether the goal is cure, living with cancer as a chronic disease, or responding to progression of illness. And the palliative care team will work in collaboration with your oncology team. I think that's really important to understand. When getting the palliative care team involved doesn't mean that all your active treatment will stop and should stop. You can do both, and together they can work very well. So the goals of palliative care or supportive care are to improve your quality of life. Now this is individualized because everyone has their own ideas of what that actually means and where your limits are and what you're trying to achieve. It involves physical symptom management along with psychosocial support. And this is a really important one. We can empower the patient and the family through education about what's happening within their disease and their treatment. Assistance with complex treatment decisions, and that comes through, again, education and understanding. And the advanced care planning, which Louise touched on before, is a really important tenet of this, to think about where you're going in the future and what path you want to follow. So this is a really interesting slide, just sort of helps illustrate the different models of palliative care in oncology. So on the left, we start with, you have standalone services, and they receive a referral from an oncologist or a GP, and they take over the palliative care. You can have a co-located palliative clinic, and they can be within a short distance from the cancer clinic or hospital. And then what you see a lot of, especially in the larger cancer centres in Australia, they're an integrated oncology and palliative clinic area where you can come in and out of either or both services as you require through your treatment. So oncology palliative care, and when you may benefit from palliative care can be, yes, during the last days of life, but there's also many other times you can. A time of cancer progression, that point where things are, the treatment's not working, we need to stop and rethink we need to recalibrate, where are we going next? And at that time, you're often experiencing some symptoms or some problems, perfect timing for the palliative or supportive care team to get involved. During your treatment, as a lot of you have probably experienced the side effects and problems, the palliative care or supportive care team can be very useful to help you through those problems. And even as early as the first time that you're diagnosed with lung cancer, you can get the involvement of the palliative care team. Especially at that first diagnosis, there's often some symptoms that have led you to investigate and present to a doctor, and we find the diagnosis of lung cancer. So depending on your needs and available services, you can access palliative care through outpatient clinics. That's where you'll come in and spend some time with the doctor, and maybe just from a clinic review, and might even be doing some work with a therapist, like a physiotherapist, helping with some exercise and movement, doing some assessments and some assistance with something like diet review. It could be while you're an inpatient at a hospital or hospice. And it's even at home. There's a lot of home-based care services now. It varies state to state and region as to what's available and what's actually going to suit you and your needs at the time. So I'm going to give a little bit of a case study here just to show the integration of where a palliative care service can work alongside someone receiving treatment for lung cancer. So this is a case study around a 48-year-old lady. She had unfortunately diagnosed with a stage 4 lung cancer in her right lung, and she started on some immunotherapy treatment. Now, her oncologist referred her to palliative care clinic for some symptom control. In particular, she was having problems with the breathlessness on exertion, so having difficulty catching her breath and being able to go about her activities during a day. She was experiencing pain on that right side of her chest, and unfortunately coughing up blood. You may have heard the term hemoptysis. That's the fancy word for coughing up blood. Coupled with this, due to treatment and her disease, she had a poor appetite, which led to reduced food intake and then weight loss. And many of you struggle with nutrition needs throughout your treatment and through your cancer. This patient also had so on her CT chest that was done, there was a large right lower lobe mass, and this in turn caused narrowing of the right side of her main airway, and unfortunately the cancer has spread to the right side rib, which was contributing to the pain she was experiencing. So what was able to be done for this lady, this patient? Analgesia was arranged for pain control. So she had a combination of long-acting and short-acting opioid medication. Targin is a drug that many of you may be familiar with. It is given twice a day, 12 hours apart. And then the endone was given as what you may have heard the term breakthrough. It's an additional top-up pain control. There was palliative radiotherapy referral was organized to help stop the bleeding, in particular with this coughing up of blood. So she had what we call 30 gray, which is a dose of radiotherapy. It was given in 10 sessions, once a day over 2 weeks. Would have been probably a Monday to Friday experience for her. And then also was included as recommendation was a small dose of oral morphine. You may know it as a word of MS content. And that helps you with the breathing, particularly at the point where having trouble catching your breath, especially if pain's involved. So a dietitian review was organised and support to look at diet and interventions. And fortunately, the patient was able to regain weight, was able to get more control over their oral intake. Another aspect for this patient that was really important when we talk about the whole holistic care, she was having some difficulties with her family relationships. She had a husband and a 3-year-old son. So she received some psychological support from the palliative care team, along with a social worker. Assistance was provided to manage anxiety and talk through her concerns about the future. So I guess I've ended with a case study, which is aspects of care that a lot of you may be familiar with. It just gives you some idea about, you know, there's lots of different aspects of care that can be provided that everyone can work together to help you out. So this slide now I've shown is just some of the different services and support that we have here at Lung Foundation. And I think we've got some questions now to pass on with everybody. And so we might start with the first question that we have here. How do you access patient palliative care and who refers me? I might pass this over to Louise to answer that.
Yeah, again, that may be different depending on where you are around, because I understand everyone's ringing in from across the country, is that
right? Yeah, correct.
So for our service, it would be a doctor referring to us. So that could either be your treating oncologist or your GP. So it really, and again, I guess it depends on what services from palliative care are available in your area or close to you. So it would be a doctor normally, although some services accept referrals from community nurses as well. I hope that answers that question. And the next question is how to talk to my family and get them involved in my palliative care. It can be hard to talk to them when they don't want to hear anything about disease progression. Yeah, that's a really tough one. And it's interesting because in that, I hope that everyone was able to hear BJ Miller in that short video when he acknowledged that it's really difficult for families to kind of acknowledge changes that are happening for someone that they love. And sometimes people just don't want to acknowledge that at all. I think it can always help to perhaps maybe bring a family member along to an appointment to enable some of that discussion to happen. Maybe if there's a social worker that might be connected with your team, they're really great, or your primary nurse would be really great to try and open up some of that conversation. And sometimes it's about giving the permission as well to talk about it. Like, you know, wondering if it would be okay to talk about some things that I've been thinking about. This is what my doctor's saying. You know, would it be okay if we can talk about that? Sometimes you might need to have an external person that can help with that.
Louise, I've got a question I was thinking to ask you, and it's something that we're seeing more younger women in particular with lung cancer. Mm. If you've got any ideas or advice about children and how to talk to children about palliative care and death and dying. I know it's very difficult to talk to anyone, but it must be incredibly tough to talk to children.
Yes, it is. And I think it depends on the developmental age of children as well. But I guess the consensus is that it's best to make children aware of the illness and what to expect in some ways, because there can be a tendency to protect children from the knowledge of what's happening. But what I find in my work is that children are very perceptive, and they will have often worked out that something's not quite right. And if they don't have any, if they're not allowed to ask questions or don't feel they're allowed to ask questions or talk about things, then they might imagine even worse scenarios than what might be actually happening. But the Cancer Council have actually put out some really good resources about how to talk to children based on their developmental age. I can, during the next question, maybe do a little bit of looking up on the best web link to get to you on that one. But it's how to talk to children about cancer, I think, is the name of the resource.
Mm, it's a fantastic book.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just gives you some strategies based on each developmental age of a child right up to adolescence.
Mm. Yeah, it's a great book that we have. Yeah, it looks like we've got a couple of more questions coming in. Just good, so we'll sit here and try and look do a presentation. How to Talk to Kids About Cancer, I think it's called. Yeah, it's a fantastic booklet. I've said that on to a few people. And it's such an individual thing, isn't it? You know, what to do and also getting schools to be aware of what's happening with the kids as well. Unfortunately, some behavioural changes can occur. Depends on the individual.
Oftentimes, schools have school counsellors that you can also engage to help support children at school as well.
That's right.
So there's another question. Understand in some countries, palliative care is not referred to until end of life is close. From your perspective, what are the strengths and weaknesses of this approach? I can't think of a lot of strengths, to be honest with you, because it's always best if palliative care can be involved in some way in that preparation time as someone's coming closer to the end of their life, rather than coming in right at the 11th hour and be a strange person that needs to quickly build a relationship. If we've been involved along the course of that person's journey, then that person has gotten to know us and trust us, and we know them and their families. So it's kind of an easier transition. I don't like to use the word easy because it's not an easy time, obviously, but it can be a smoother transition, I guess, towards the end if there's some support for that person and family, rather than leaving everything to the last minute and then trying to put in essentially a band-aid on a situation. So if we're involved earlier, it's always a strength, I think.
Yeah. And I guess that also comes in with when we talked about advanced care planning, you know, when we talk about empowering the patient to be actively involved in their care. Unfortunately, when, you're coming towards the end stage of an illness, you're often too unwell and too many other things going on to actually provide that input as to what you would like done. And that's where, you know, if a patient, you have some very strong views about what you would like to be done and where you think you're going to, it's really important to have those conversations with your family and your important people in your life right from the start, because when you're getting really unwell, you're not able to do that, you know. And if you're a bit like me, if you've got a bit of a control freak streak, and you want to be in control right to the end, well, that's the time to do it, because you may not have that opportunity later on. Yeah. As well. And I think, you know, to really put your stamp on your end of life where you want it to be and how you want it to be.
Yeah, that can be very empowering, and you don't have to be diagnosed with a serious illness to do that. So, for example, I've got completed an advanced health directive that goes into great detail. There wasn't actually enough room in all of the boxes for me to write all of my wishes. And I guess it's beyond just your wishes. It's more about your values and what's important to you. So if it's really important for you to have the doctors and nurses caring for you to be really honest about where things are going, then, you know, complete some paperwork and have those discussions with the team looking after you. If it's important for you to have a certain person or family member or close friend that you really trust to make decisions about your healthcare when you're not in a position to, then it's important to appoint those people ahead of time while you're well and able to do that. It just, it sort of saves reacting to a crisis situation in when everyone's really distressed. So if you've got a good plan ahead of time about sitting down, working out what's important to you, what sort of care would you want as things are not going so well for you, or if you're coming closer to the end of life, and what sort of care would you not want, what would not be of benefit to you? And it's important to have your conversations with your doctor looking after you about that as well.
Yeah.
Because sometimes what you're wanting is not really consistent with good medical practice either. So it's really important to have those conversations, and if you've got any questions to raise them, or ask for a longer appointment, or if you've only got a short check-in appointment with your oncology team, just go in with a list of, this is what I've been thinking about and these are the questions I have. Can we please make some time to talk about them? So
that's right, and that's the importance of letting your family know where you're at too, because unfortunately for your family, it can be extremely distressing to hear. You know, the first instinct from a family member is to want to fight and do anything they can for the person that they love. And they, of course, they don't want them to go. Mm. But unfortunately, if that's going to be inevitable, it's to then get through that and then to start having those really great conversations with your loved one, so you can really support them right through to the end.
That's right. And even to things like, are there family members that are overseas that perhaps need to, you know, if health is deteriorating, you know, do they need to come back? And I guess the answer is always yes to that, because that's precious opportunities to spend precious and quality time with family at that time as well. So there was another question: is there benefit in calling palliative care supportive care before the end of life is close? So that was a follow-up to a previous question about the strengths and weaknesses of referring to palliative care when the end is close. So I think, I think there is some merit in that. I think maybe saying palliative and supportive care, there is a movement at the moment that some services are calling themselves that as well. Our service is palliative care. We don't have supportive care in our name, but that is what we do. Maybe there would be some benefit in that, in taking the fear and the anxiety out of that. I think that's a good point. Okay, I think we're. We've just got, just to add on to the resource from the Cancer Council, is called Talking to Kids About Cancer. So if you put that in your search engine, Cancer Council Talking to Kids About Cancer, it's like, I can't remember how many pages, but it's quite a good sized resource anyway.
Yeah, and it's available online as a PDF, or you can, if you ring 13 11 20 and talk to someone at Cancer Council, they're likely to be able to send you a hard copy if you really wanted a hard copy. Yeah. All right. Anything that you'd like to add, Louise, about palliative and supportive care at this point?
I guess.
Any other case studies or examples of a good use of palliative and supportive care?
Look to the next slide. Actually, while I was travelling here this evening, a patient that I cared for very briefly, actually, about 2 years ago, popped into my mind. And he was a gentleman with lung cancer who, on diagnosis, had a lot of problems with pain. The location of the cancer in his lung was in such a place that it really affected his surrounding nerves. And so he had a lot of problems with nerve pain that was quite difficult to control. But he was referred to our service by the GP, and then we referred on for radiation to the PA hospital radiation oncology team there. So he had a combination of radiation treatment, and we managed his medication. So we managed it with Tajin, as we've spoken about, and also some medication for the nerve pain specifically. So he had such a good response to the radiation treatment. It really settled the pain down. We actually were able to slightly reduce his painkiller medication as well. And then when I saw him, he came into clinic, and he was so well and so busy getting out there doing his normal living that he didn't really have time to come and see us in palliative care clinic anymore, and nor did he really have the need to. So we discussed actually discharging him from our service at that point, and with the proviso that the GP could refer at any time if needed. So I think that we look after people at all kind of aspects of that journey. You know, sometimes we're involved intensely for a period of time, and then once things settle down, we can back off for a period of time as well. Or sometimes we're referred, like the questions that came through earlier, right at the very end, and we can do the best we can to make sure that that person's death is very peaceful in terms of managing any symptoms that are a worry, and we can do the best we can in supporting families. But it would be nice to be able to know them just a bit earlier, to be able to make that transition even better for them as a family, because I guess that person's story doesn't just affect them, but it affects everyone around them in their community, their family, their friends. It kind of mushrooms out, really, doesn't it? And it can have a really big impact. So if we can kind of help support that as much as possible a bit earlier, then it's better all round, because that family and that community then need to, after that person does die, need to then adjust to living life without them. And so that's the other part of palliative care is bereavement support. So the level of support that we provide in palliative and supportive care doesn't just stop when that person does die. We often provide support for the loved ones who sometimes find it really difficult to cope with that person no longer being there. And so we often have a long relationship with relatives after their loved one has died as well. So it's kind of full circle, looking after the family.
That's really great.
Yeah, it does. And I was just thinking too, you know, where our stage four lung cancer patients in particular, you know, there's a particular subtype with all the new treatments we're getting now, and like immunotherapies and targeted therapies, and they're really pushing the numbers that when I first started working in lung cancer, you know, 15, 20 years ago, you know, the period of time that you would expect someone to maybe live with that lung cancer was under a year. But we're getting people who are living, you know, years later, 3-4 years later, still a stage four lung cancer that we can't cure, but they're actually managing to be able to live with the cancer. And they're able to, you know, require some help and some support though with symptoms, so they can live a good life.
Yes.
And I think as new treatments continue, the use of supportive care or palliative care, whichever way you want to say it, I think it's going to be increased and going to be more warranted. And maybe that's going to help get rid of some of the, you know, the impression of what palliative care is about. It's not just for when you're about to die. It's for so you can live with your lung cancer and live a life that you want to live as an individual. Yeah, it's going to be very big changes over the future.
Seen so many changes from, you know, based on what you were saying, particularly in the last 5 years, even, you know, definitely across the number of years I've been doing this work, people are living much longer. It's almost more like chronic conditions in some respects, where, you know, there's a much longer time frame, but still some issues with that can impact your quality of life. So yeah, I think it's even more important, really, that you've got some supports alongside.
Yeah. I like to coin the term, let's live with cancer and not die from cancer.
Yeah.
And I think as we're getting people living longer, you know, we're all pushing that, and we all hope for that future for all our patients and what we can do. And of course, the families who are caring for those people. Yeah. So I think at this point, we don't have any more questions. Everyone's a little bit shy tonight, but I hope that what we've provided you has given you some food for thought and some ideas. So you'll see on the screen, if anything comes to mind, maybe, you know, will come to you when you least expect. There's people that you can contact to get some help. We have our free call support number of 1800 654 301. The Cancer Council are always a fantastic source of support on 13 11 20. We have, of course, and then if anyone's really particularly distressed by any of the topics that we've brought up today, so do understand that they're quite emotive talking about death and dying. 13 11 14 will get you through the Lifeline. They're available 24 hours and they're fantastic people to help talk through some of the way, the fears and your feelings. And a new service that we've become aware of called Carer's Couch. And they're on 0413 702 098. All right. So we are now coming to a close on our final webinar. Right. And then again, there's our website. Of course, I also forgot. All right. So we're now coming to a close on this, our final webinar. Thank you for your time tonight. This is supportive care in lung cancer. I'd like to remind you all that if you want to talk about anything else that we discussed, again, here's our numbers to call. Now, a survey link will be sent to you within the next few days for the entire series. Please complete the survey to give your feedback about the webinar series. We want to hear about the good, the bad, and any suggestions for future webinars that we might do for you. This webinar has been made possible by Cancer Australia Supporting People with Cancer Grant Initiative, and that has been funded by the Australian Government. I'd like to thank you again, our guest presenter, Louise Durham, and her years of knowledge and experience in palliative care. And again, thank you everyone for joining us. And we'll see you next time when we come around to more webinars. Have a great evening, everyone.
Thank you. Good night.